I think there is an element in the music that doesn't come from one individual's input. It comes from the what we generate between the four of us together. And I think that carries over through records and through gigs. People can feel it. People feel that they come from us. When you're actually in the band and make the music and write songs, all you is write the song as you feel them at the moment. You can't sort of turn off the inspiration as it comes on. It's not like going to the kitchen doing that.
So he's only quick with those little comparisons.
That's really what Stuart was. Stuart loved an audience, and he loved playing, and he loved the fact that people loved his music and were turned on by it. And it's as simple as that. He didn't write songs for the media, and unfortunately in this country, it's quite sad at them because record companies wants to write records for what they think the media might like or what television might like, you know, and music don't really go together very well, you know, and it is an unbearable kind of pressure. That atmosphere that Eddie describes in Nashville. Can we not have some of this in Scotland, please? Mm-hmm. You know,
I think it's a bit better in Scotland.
And it is south.
I feel that definitely. When I come, I definitely feel that it's a bit more, I don't know, just a bit better. You know, you've got people like wonderful Michael Marr, who
absolutely
flourishes in Scotland,
yeah.
You know.
And an audience
and people
likes
Tom Waits, who loves Michael Marr, you know. Tom Waits is just this king of songwriting. And yet, you know, Michael could come down here and play, I don't know how many people he plays to down here, but, you know, there's not many people. I mean, I just think that Scotland's got a bit of an edge on.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure Stuart would be thrilled to be his name mentioned in the same sentence as both Michael Marr and Tom Waits. Also with us, another singer who has memories of Stuart Adams is Carol Lawler. How did you first meet Stuart? How did you come to work with him?
The first time I met him was doing a TV show for Honey, strangely enough. I never actually met him, I just watched him watching me from the stage. And from that came, I think, the Ian Grant approached me to sing on Eclectic. They were doing a couple of nights gigs in Dingwalls, and at which point they were going to record an album, a live album, with a band. And as Billy said, there were four proponents that made the band up, but everyone was welcome. There was about eight on stage that night, which went on to become a tour and included Ireland and stuff. But really, any time you met the guy, it was just a really, really warm experience, a really nice experience.
Not the business of just, you know, going into the kitchen and doing it. He was very simple and straightforward in his approach to the music. There was no grandstanding ever.
Never at all, and very focused. You know, there was a job to be done. And I never knew Stuart as an alcoholic or drunk. Anyway, obviously I knew he was an alcoholic, but it's a shame that, you know, you read in the paper Stuart Adamson alcoholic, when really we should be reading Stuart Adamson articulate, intelligent, funny, handsome, all those kind of things.
And maybe we should also be, you know, saying Stuart Adamson, what went wrong, or, you know, how was he let down, Eddie? Because this is a business which puts, you know, intolerable pressure on people.
Yeah, I think that I've known many, you know, beautiful, gorgeous, sensitive, usually blokes, actually, unfortunately, that are complete victim to drink. And I was shocked when I heard that Stuart had that particular problem. I think actually when I knew him, he was clean of it.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I've heard since. So that's probably why I didn't get. If only I'd known him. I do feel a bit of a twinge of guilt about maybe I could have called, because I do a lot of work myself with Al-Anon, you know, which is for friends and family, people who have drink problems, because alcoholism is not just an individual's disease, it's a family disease, it affects everybody around you. And, you know, I know that any decision he made in Hawaii was an alcoholic decision, not a Stuart Adamson's decision.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the painful thing, is that underneath that alcoholism was Stuart Adamson.
Mm-hmm.
And what makes it worse, Bruce, was there was such a sweet guy and such a creative guy under that. He wasn't thwarted in any way other, perhaps, than by some perception that came from outside himself.
Well, I think Eddie, I've puzzled over it, and I think Eddie articulated it so well there. That was an alcoholic's decision, not Stuart Adamson's decision. Because I never felt the guy when I met him. Over the years and throughout his success, and even when records weren't as successful, he didn't change at all. He was quite unfazed by the fame, mm-hmm. and unfazed when he wasn't particularly famous. You know what I mean? He was just the same guy and an enthusiast. And he also encouraged others. You know what I mean? He was a good guy as well. I mean, he would, as I say, at the Prince's Trust, you know, he met lots of young musicians then, and he was incredibly supportive. I think Carl was there that day, Carl.
Yep, that's right.
Weren't you? You know,
yep.
When Stuart was just. He was just such an ordinary Jack the Lad guy, and he never changed. And that's why I think it's so. I think that's why it's choked people up a little bit, you know. I didn't know Stuart was an alcoholic either, you know, until I read about it.
When I was working with him, he was very open about it. He was very articulate about it, and you know, came up with really heart wrenching stories about it. And that's why I was so surprised to find out that he was back on the drinkers.
Yeah.
But I mean, alcoholism is arbitrary. You don't have to be a musician or a miner. It'll choose anyone.
That's right.
That's the saddest thing about it.
I mean, the very fact that he had that kind of insight, even quite close to the end, is interesting. He was a very thoughtful guy. He was a guy who, I mean, he wasn't analytical or self-conscious, but he thought a lot. He thought a lot about other people too.
Yeah, I mean, I reckon that if, you know, we're all in this business, and this business is full of people who do sort of weird and wonderful and crazy things at times, but, you know, the old cliche that, you know, you can take the guy out of Dunfermline, but never Dunfermline out of the guy, that personified Stuart Adamson. And, I mean, I would like to think that, you know, if I had ever had any kind of problem of any kind and I had to phone somebody in the business, you know, Stuart Adamson would have been the kind of guy that you could have called him at 3 o'clock in the morning and said, look, you know, I've got a bit of a problem. Is there anything you can do to help me? And I think, you know, he would have been the first guy to rally round. And that's why, as Eddie says, you know, and she, I really have to reiterate what Bruce said. She articulated it so brilliantly. That was an alcoholic decision. That was so out of character for Stuart Adamson, because he was just the most grounded, the most level-headed, the most humble, gentle guy. And whatever was going on and whatever demons were in his head and that lonely hotel room, it was not him. It was acting. It was somebody that was acting in his behalf. Sadly,
bittersweet thoughts. But one high point in the life for you, Bruce. What was the moment you would choose to remember him by?
Well, actually, probably on stage, Dublin, 1983.
I was there, Bruce.
You were there. What a day that was.
What a
bill that was. There's Simple Minds, Eurythmics, Steel Pulse, U2's homecoming gig, and Big Country, who had just done a little triumphant tour of Ireland. And they tore the place apart that day. And it was a glorious sunny day. And it was the smile on Stuart's face that just said it all.
Well, we've been remembering Stuart Adamson, who died at the weekend. My thanks to Carol Lawler and Eddie Reader, to Bruce Findlay, Billy Sloan and Jim Leishman, to Craig and Charlie Reed of The Proclaimers, and of course to Tony Butler of Big Country. The best way, of course, to remember the guy is through the music. Here he is with the band, and one great thing, sleep well, Stuart.
I think the only reason that people pick up on the Scottishness is, and stuff is, well, I prefer to write from life, as it were, and I live in Scotland and I work and play amongst people in Scotland. And I think there's a place for us in people's hearts.
Brian Morton was remembering The Life of Stuart Adamson. A Flower in the Desert was produced by Jacqueline Houston.